Remain standing for opening prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to come together and to worship your name. Lord, thank you for the song service. And Lord, just be with us as we break open your word. And Lord, just open our hearts to hear the word and apply it to our lives. We thank you and praise you in all that you've given to this church and our church body. And we thank you and praise you in your son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, let's keep that great singing going. We're going to sing Count Your Blessings. All four verses of Count Your Blessings, 563 if you have your hymnal or look up at the screen.
When upon life's pillows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done, count your blessings, name them one by one, count your many blessings, see what God hath.
Seated for the offering.
All right, good evening. It's good to see you tonight. Before we go to the offering, we have a couple of prayer requests. The first one is for Darlene Satan, and she's on a ventilator down in Kentucky, and this is Frank Epperson's aunt. Please be in prayer for Darlene Satan. Then I ask you to pray for my Aunt Jo, Josephine Swan. She's like my grandmother. She raised my mom. I got word today that she's nearing death and ready to enter glory, so just pray for a peaceful for her. So thank you for your faithfulness and giving to God and his work and making sure you give in your tithes and offerings. And we're so thankful for your faithfulness. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, just thank you for today. We thank you, Lord, for your many blessings. I just pray, dear God, that you'll just bless our people, Lord, as they give back to you. We're so thankful that they're faithful to give during this time. Lord, we've just been able to continue to ministry here at Cornerstone and take care of our missionaries and different works around the church. I just pray, Lord, for the funds that we need for our roof. I just pray, Lord, that we'd be able to raise those just as quickly as possible so we can get that taken care of and not to have any worries there. We just pray now that you'll bless this offering for us in Christ's precious name. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's all stand one final time and go ahead and sing Sweet By and By. Thank you, Miss Kaylee, for playing that. The Love of God, How Rich and Pure. What a great song. Song number 553. We've got three verses of Sweet By and By. On that first verse,
there's a land that is fair.
Standing as pastor comes.
Please turn in your Bibles to 2 John. What we're going to do is I will read the odd verses, I will have you read the even verses, and we're going to read the entire book. Okay? All 13 verses. All right? Some of you will get that a joke in a minute. No? All right. All right. 2 John, starting in verse number 1. I'll read the odd, if you'll read the evening, please. The elder unto the elect lady and her children, whom I love in the truth, and not I only, but also all that have known the truth. Grace be unto you, mercy and peace, from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. And now I beseech thee, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment unto thee, but that which we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. For many deceivers have entered into the world, whom confess not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and an antichrist. Whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth not in the doctrine of Christ, he that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. Not, For he that biddeth him God's speed is a partaker of his evil deeds. And the children of the elect sister greet thee. Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the reading of your word. We thank you, Lord, for this short book that you gave to the apostle John for us, Lord, for our instruction in our day. I pray, God, that we would glean from it tonight, Lord, the message that you have for each and every one of our hearts. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. Thank you for reading. You may be seated. Started last week talking about this epistle. We know that this book was written by John the Apostle, and along with some other books that he had written. And his main message that he was trying to get to this church, as we talked about last week, the elect lady was the church, and her children were the members of the church. He was writing to a particular church about some things that were happening there. They were having some false teachers that were coming within their midst, and so he really had a threefold message to them. We started talking last week that he told them that they must know the truth. Now, truth, from the definition that we have from that, is that which is true or an established fact. And there are some things that this church had been taught through those that had started the church and had been teaching, and there were just some things that they needed to hold on to, and things that are truth. And we talked last week how Jesus Christ is the truth. God's word is the truth, and the Holy Spirit guides us into all truth. And I'm thankful that the Spirit is there to guide us when we are looking for answers in our life. And then we talked about how we need to know that the truth, how we need to know the truth, and how we become a child of God. And we can only become a child of God through His mercy and His grace, which is bestowed upon our lives. And then the Christian faith stands and falls on the doctrine then of Jesus Christ, or the deity of Jesus Christ. In verse number 3, he was telling us that grace be unto you and peace and mercy from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. Because as we'll get down tonight in the verses that we'll look at tonight, that there were people coming in saying that Jesus was not the Christ. And we need to make sure that we understand the different doctrines. Doctrine is an important thing for us to know. That's why we read our Bible. That's why we study the Bible. That's why we come to church. We should come to Sunday school. So as these doctrines, as these truths are being taught, we can engraft them into our lives. It's probably good for us to study Bible doctrines. One of the things that I'm considering doing here in the near future, just starting to talk about the doctrines that we need to believe in. Many of you have been raised in church all of your life, and you understand those things. And there are some people that are new Christians, and they may not understand all of those things. It's just important thing for us to do. But we must know the truth. And then we talked a little bit last week in verses 4 through 6 that we must walk in the truth. Now, to walk in the truth means to obey it, to permit it to control every area of our life. And that's all part of being a child of God. Now, when we walk in the truth, we bring joy to the hearts of the Lord. And then also, as a pastor, when the church family is walking in truth and they're obeying God's word, it brings joy to the pastor's heart. You could think of those of you who are parents in here, and you have children that have been raised in the word of God, and they continue after they're adults, and they're still in church, and they're still following the doctrines of God. And I know that I think we had grade check this week. And in school, right? I think what I was told. And so there are some parents that were very happy about the report that they're going to get about their child. And there are some children that are not so happy about the report that they're going to get because we like to hear that our children are doing well. No parent likes when somebody says, "I need to talk to you," because usually when a teacher walks up and says, "I need to talk to you," what's our first thought? It's negative. Okay, what'd they do? And in that. And so as John was writing, he said, you know, that he was happy, greatly rejoiced that he found the children, those of the church that he was writing to, they were still walking in truth, but still he was concerned about their well-being. And then we talked about when we walk in the truth, we are showing obedience to his commands. And it's important for us to be obedient in following the Lord. And so this is where we'll pick up tonight in verses 5 and 6, that when we walk in the truth, we will love others the right way. If we are walking in truth, if we are walking the way God wants us to, if we are obeying his commandments, then we will know how to love one another. The commandment, love one another, is certainly not anew in our time. But even in the Old Testament, the Jews were instructed to love their neighbors as well as strangers. In the book of Leviticus, chapter number 19, in verses 18 and 34, we read these words. It says this, "Thou shalt not avenge, nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people." It's talking about the other Jews, those that they were wandering through the wilderness with. It says, "But thou shalt love thy neighbor," how? "As thyself." Have we heard that before? Sure, in the New Testament. Jesus wrapped up all the commands. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy might. And the second commandment is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. How many people in here hate themselves? I mean, you get up in the morning and you look at your face and you go, "I can't stand you." "I can't stand you either," the mirror says back. And in that, none of us are that way. Now, there are some aspects we may look and say that we don't like about ourselves, but really, we all like each other. I mean, we like ourselves. I mean, if I was to pick up a hymn book and go to throw it at you, what are you going to do? You're going to defend yourself. You're not going to go, "Well, go ahead. I don't like myself anyway." Right? You could talk back, right? Or does somebody want me to hit them in the face with a hymn book? No, you can't point at, you're not allowed to point at your husband, Kaylee. Okay, and in that, I'm not, all right. But it says that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves. Listen to this as it continues to go on. "I am the Lord, but the stranger that dwelleth with you shall be unto you as one born among you, and thou shalt love him as thyself." So not only are we supposed to love our brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, but we're supposed to love those from without the church. Christians should be the most loving people in all the world. Now, that doesn't mean that you should go barefoot and put flowers in your hair and sing Kumbaya and do all that stuff, okay? But we should be loving towards those that are around us. Our neighbors should not see us as that grumpy old man or that nasty old woman, but they should see us as reflections of Jesus Christ. And here, even all the way back in the Old Testament, it was written for them to do so. Let's look at verses 5 and 6. It says, "And now I beseech thee, lady," or church, not as I wrote a new commandment, some new instruction, not a new suggestion, but a new commandment unto you, but that which we had from the beginning, that ye love one another. And this is love, that we walk after his commandments. And this is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, that ye should walk in it. So we should be displaying love. Now, is it possible to command love? Yes or no? Yes. I knew people would say no. Yes, it is. Because that's what we have. It's not a suggestion. We are told that we are to love. Now, how many of you, when you were growing up, got in a fight with a brother or sister, got in trouble with the parents, and they made you, "Okay, now hug and tell each other that you love one another. Love you, like to." That's what we're thinking. You can't tell me to love somebody. You can't make me love somebody. Word of God says it's a command. When Jesus Christ reiterated it in the New Testament, he was talking about the commandments. He said, "The second is like unto the first. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." You're not allowed to be that grumpy old man. I'm just a grumpy old man, and that's just the way I am. No, that's not the way you're supposed to be. And if that's just the way you am, then you am sinning. Hello? Oh, me? I mean, amen or oh, me? Is this thing on?
Amen.
Amen. Right? I mean, really, do all of us like everybody that we meet? No. Put me in a car for 5 minutes. I come to that grumpy old man, and I've gotten a whole lot better and in that. But is it possible to command love? Yes, when you understand what Christian love really is. Now, many people have mistaken the idea that Christian love is a feeling, a special kind of religious emotion that makes us reach out and accept one another. As long as we have this robe of human flesh on us and we're on this side of heaven, can I tell you, we're never going to get that way. Now, there are some people, especially grandparently people, that just seem to love everybody. And you'll see kids flock to those type of people that have that love. People like to be around loving people. Many of you can think about relatives that when your parents said, hey, we're getting ready to go visit Aunt so-and-so or Grandma so-and-so, you were like, yes. Then there are others that you were like, oh, I'm sick. I don't want to go. But that's not what it is. Christian love is an act of the will. It simply means treating other people the very same way that Jesus treated you. Now, do you know that it is possible to love people that you don't even like? It is. We may not be able to will our affections at all time, but we can will our attitude and our actions. When people are rude to us and we try to be kind in return, we may not feel like doing that, but we can will ourselves to do that. Sometimes we really have to keep ourselves in check, don't we? Keep ourselves in check. Now, when people persecute us, we can pray for them. And when opportunities come, we can do good to them. If we followed our feelings, we would probably retaliate every time, wouldn't we? Sure we would. But if we ask for the Spirit to control our wills, and we can act towards them as Jesus would have acted towards us in Christian love. Now, if you study when Jesus was on the cross, the Word of God tells us that both of the criminals on either side railed on him for a while. And then one of them started to realize, you know what? He's not yelling back. You know, you can only fight when somebody is fighting back. And sometimes people just get real mad when somebody doesn't fight back. Sister told me a story one time where she's just a fighter. She's a last word person. And she was just going off on my brother-in-law. And he just looked at her. He could have broken her in half. Just looked at her. Said with a low voice, are you done? Are you through? Made her so mad, she wanted him to fight back. She even threw a phone at him. Not a cell phone. Remember those good old Ma Bell phones? Because I asked her, I said, what happened to the wall? That's where I got the story. You know, if we don't retaliate back and we just show Christian love, what did Jesus do from the cross? And there are people screaming and yelling at him. The other guys are screaming and yelling at him. And what does he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now, did he feel like doing that? He was God. But I wouldn't have felt like doing that. But if I'm keeping my emotions in check, then can I pray for the Spirit to will my spirit to do the right thing? Verse number 6. And this is a love that we walk after his commandments. And this is the commandment that as we have heard from the beginning. And what are we hearing from the beginning? Thou shalt love. Okay. And that we love one another. Then it says we should walk in it. You realize that love and obedience must go together. Love and obedience must go together. Now, as we review just what we've learned so far, we see three themes that blend: truth and love and obedience. It is by believing the truth in Christ and in the Word that we are saved. The evidence of salvation is love and obedience, but the love and obedience are strengthened as we grow in knowledge of the truth, and we grow in knowledge of the truth through the Word of God. We speak the truth in love and obey God's commandments because we love Him. Obedience enables us to learn more about the truth, and more truth than the more truth that we learn, the more we love Jesus Christ, who is the truth. So instead of us living in a vicious circle, we can learn to live in a victorious circle of love and of truth and of obedience. If you want to be that grumpy old man, you can choose to do that, and you can live that way, but you're being disobedient to God's command. And trust me, I understand, it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of work to learn to act and not react to things. That doesn't mean that we're not going to blow it from time to time. But that's no excuse to do it either. So the third thing, we must know the truth. We must walk in the truth. And then in verses 7 through 11, we learn that we must abide in the truth. We must abide in the truth. Why is that? Well, look at verse number 7. For many deceivers have entered into the world who confess not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and antichrist. We're given instruction in verse number 8. Look to yourselves that we lose not those things which we have wrought. We'll talk about that here in just a minute. But that we receive a full reward. Now, to abide in the truth means that, means to remain true to the basic doctrines or to the basic teachings of the faith. So we need to understand, we need to be studying the Word of God to understand what they are. Well, then it says, then we have to ask the question, because he wrote it in here, there are many deceivers. What is a deceiver? The word deceiver implies much more than just teaching a false doctrine. It includes, leading people into wrong living. We'll talk about that. Now, we must believe, what we believe determines how we behave. Let me say that again. What we believe determines how we behave. Wrong doctrine will lead us to wrong living. And they always go together. They always go together. So where did these deceivers and false teachers come from originally? Sadly, they came from the church. 1 John chapter 2 and verses 18 and 19 says this, little children, it is the last time. And as we have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now there are many Antichrist, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us. These were people that used to know or believed in the doctrines, did those things, but they went out from us. But they were not. But they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would not have continued with us. But they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not that they were not all of us. Now, at one time, these people professed that they believed that the faith which was once delivered unto the saints in Jude 3. They once believed that, but now they believe something else. Brother Dave was telling us this morning in Sunday school how he had a friend that doesn't even to this day was raised in church, was raised right, heard the right doctrines and stuff, that even today doesn't even believe at all anymore. Just doesn't believe in that. And probably many of us could think of people that used to sit in and around us that, you know, the devil just got to them. And they just started going into the world, started listening to the world's philosophies and the things that the world was teaching and stuff, and they just walked away from what they once believed. These people now have turned from the faith and abandoned the truth, and they've also, when you abandon truth, you abandon the church. Now, if we are not careful, it tells us in Acts chapter 20, verse 30, also of our own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things and drawn away from disciples after them. Now, remember, it takes constant spiritual vigilance to protect a family or a local church from insidious attacks of false teachers. There will be people that will come in and people will hear a little bit about them or hear a little bit about their teaching and stuff, and they'll say, oh man, this guy is really good, or this person's really got this on lock. But slowly but surely, they just start putting a little bit of false teaching, a little bit more false teaching, and pretty soon they've led people away. Now, why did many fall away? According to John chapter, or to 2 John 7, tells us in 2 Peter, they believed a lie. 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 said this, and there were false prophets among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privately shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying that the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow in their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of the truth shall be evil spoken of. Now, we're also told in the book of 2 Timothy, in the last days, perilous times shall come. Now, we as Christians, we can look to the Word of God and see what is right and wrong. But you try to put that into a worldly thought process of people, they say we're the evil ones. If you stand for pro-life, if you believe that life began at conception, you're wrong. You're a hater. If you believe that marriage is between one man and one woman for a lifetime, you're a hater. I was on a walk Saturday morning, I think, and I walked past one of my neighbor's houses, had a sign out front. And they said, these are the things we believe, and one of them was love is love, no matter what. If you believe that God created a man and created a woman, and that's who they're supposed to love, you're a hater. I told people, I said, once we start accepting homosexuality as something, and we don't hold it to the Bible truth, it won't be long before pedophilia comes out. And guess what people are pushing now? Hey, after all, the sign said it all. Love is love. That's why it's important for us to understand and to know the doctrines. There are churches that are standing for homosexual rights, standing for pro-choice rights. And then we can go down the list of different things that are there. And you stand on the Word of God today, you're the one with a problem. No, I'm just standing for what is true. But there are people within the church that are saying, you know, we really need to kind of back off on all of this. We, you know, it's that way. You know what? I don't have a religion. I have a relationship with Jesus Christ. And my Savior gave me some instructions. He gave me the Word of God and said, this is truth. this is what you need to follow. Getting ready to celebrate 41 years as a church, the truth has always been preached from this sacred desk. And until the Lord comes back, the truth had always better be preached from this sacred desk. You should keep whoever is up here in check. Mark Twain said this, a lie can run around the world while truth is putting on its shoes. We've learned to believe lies. Human nature wants to believe lies. They want to resist the word of God. Our human nature does. And we could see in 2 Peter 2 that we just read, the devious method of the apostates is to seduce unwary and unstable people. I remember there used to be a show called Somebody's Wild Kingdom. Merloson, or I can't remember what the guy's name was. Something Wild Kingdom. I remember as a kid watching that, they would show you lions on the hunt. And what did the lions always look for? The biggest, the bravest, the boldest lion to go. I mean, you know, the biggest animal to go after. No. They look for the weak and feeble. That's why it's important for us to keep ourselves spiritually healthy, because Satan will know exactly where to get in and where to get us tripped up from. Now, they are even called Antichrist. Now, the Greek prefix anti means both instead of or against. These teachers were against Christ because they denied that Jesus indeed was God in the flesh. If you'd like to flip over a couple of pages to 1 John chapter number 4. 1 John chapter number 4, verses 1 through 4. John is teaching this truth to the people. He says this, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof we have heard that it should come. And even now, already, it is in the world." Even back in John's day, the spirit of Antichrist was already there, just like it is in our day. Verse number 4. "Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." If you know Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you have that Holy Spirit of promise. He is sealed inside of you. You have that ability. It's better than Popeye's can of spinach in a time. And in that, we have the Holy Spirit that can help us to overcome all of these things, the false teaching, give us the ability to do the things that the Lord would have us to do. And here's John is writing to this church. He is telling them that you need to be aware that these people are there, and you need to keep yourself spiritually healthy. Verse number 8, he told them of the danger of going back. He points out three dangers to the church members here, they will face because of the deceivers in the world. Number one, the first thing that he says in verse number 8 is this: there's the danger of going back, are becoming backslidden. It says, "Look to yourselves, that we lose not those things which we have wrought," those things that we have toiled for, or have been engaged in, or the things that we have worked for spiritually, "but that ye receive a full reward." All of us want, if we do a full week's work, we want a full week's worth of pay, don't we? I mean, if we've put the work in, we want the money. If you've put the work in spiritually, you should want the spiritual strength that you need to have. And you need to work at it. And we need to work on it. And here it says that we have wrought, and we want to have that full reward. says, look to yourselves, beware, take heed of the things which ye have wrought. And now church members need to respect the work of the faithful pastors and faithful teachers and do everything to protect and extend the things that they have learned. What a tragedy it is when God's servants labor faithfully to build up a church and then the work is destroyed by false teaching. It's important for us to know what we need to know so that we're not going backwards. Then the second danger is found in verse number 9, the danger of going ahead. It says, for whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine hath not God. For he that abideth in the doctrine of Christ hath both the Father and the Son. Now, the word translated transgress means to run ahead or too far and to pass beyond the assigned limits. You know what? There's only so much we can do. Now, Jesus knew, just like we talked about this morning, Jesus knew the strength that Peter had. Now, Peter was going to end up being one of the strongest, most boldest leaders of the disciples. It's from you go from John to the book of Acts, and you just see Peter's boldness as it grows and as it grows and as it grows. And that's the way it should be for us. But he knew what his limitations were. Peter thought that he was ready right then. I think one of the greatest things my father ever did for me was not sign the paper saying that I can go into the Navy right out of high school. My dad kept telling me, they'll eat you alive. He says, you need to go to Bible college first. They'll eat you alive. I'm thinking, man, Dad, I'm a leader in my youth group. I know this. I know that. I've got to go to Christian school for 1 year. I'm ready. He knew what it was like. I didn't go to boot camp till I had been out of the house for 2 years and in a Bible institute and a Bible college for those 2 years. You know what I found out? Those 3 months that I was in boot camp and then went to hospital corps school, my dad was right. I thought I was strong, but they would have eaten me alive. You know why? Because I watched them eat other young Christian men alive while I was in boot camp. And it was tough, and it was a struggle. But thank God I made it through, and thank the Lord. And I thank him often for a father that could see that his son wasn't ready. It wasn't till later that I was able to do what I wanted to do. And Peter, same thing. We need to make sure that we don't get ahead of God. The danger here is that going beyond our limits, the word of going beyond our limits of the word of God, we start to add two things to God. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 18 tells us this, for I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. We need to make sure that we understand exactly what the word of God means. The word abideth means to remain, to make a permanent arrangement. In John chapter 10 verses 28 and 29, it tells us this, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my Father's hands. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hands. God gave us the Holy Spirit to teach us and to lead us into new understanding and application of the truth. Jesus said these words in John chapter 16, verses 12 through 16. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit he, when the Spirit of truth is come, he shall guide you into all truth. For he shall speak not of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, and he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, therefore said I that he shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. A little while and ye shall not see me, and again a little while and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. We must consistently be growing, and as this will help us not to be swayed by the deceivers. Bible tells us and challenges us in 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 18 this way, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, not only is there a danger of us getting behind or danger of us going ahead, but there's a danger of us going with the deceivers. Look at verse number 10. It says, and if there come any unto you that bring not this doctrine, the doctrine of truth, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. Now, John warned the family, the church, not to accept false teachers who are visiting them, wanting fellowship with them, or perhaps enjoying their hospitality. Now, you have to understand, in this culture, hospitality was extremely important. And especially, it was important in Christian ministry in that day, because there were very few inns where travelers could stay. So especially Christians who wanted to keep, who wanted to witness to people, oftentimes would have those people come into their home. But they were also warned not to, to be wary of the evil influence of the world. Christians were admonished to open up their homes to visitors. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2, and be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for whereby some have entertained angels unaware. But we must use caution. Must be careful about what we listen to. Now, whether you like Christian radio or not, it's up to you. But you need to be careful about who you listen to. Because a lot of times we can get, just because people call it Christian doesn't make it Christian. And we need to run it through the filter of God's word. And be careful. I remember when Heartland Baptist Bible College started, and I had an opportunity to sit down with Brother Sam Davison. We were having lunch together. I think he was preaching revival here or something, and we got to talking about school. Me and him graduated from the same Bible college, and I was talking to him, and I asked him, I said, Brother Sam, have you ever thought about having a degree exchange program? He goes, what? And I said, well, you know, it's kind of hard to say that I'm proud to have graduated from the Bible college that I graduated from. And he just looked at me and he goes, you know what, Brother Rick? He said, back in the days that we went to school, he said, we were taught by some very good men. He said, and you may not want to use the name or whatever, and that's up to you. But he said, I know that we got solid teaching. He said, but let me caution you about something. He said, if we're not careful, says Heartland could end up the same way. He said, it's going to take men to hold our feet to the fire. And that's very true. I grew up hearing about the Bible college I graduated from. Many great men. I would have never thought that it would have fallen. And you'll hear of people that fall all the time. That's why it's important for us to stay true to this. It shouldn't be thus saith Pastor Rick. It's thus saith the Lord. And we back it up with the word of God. We need to be cautious. Tells us and warns us in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 again. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they be of God. Because many false prophets are there. What was John so adamant about? Why was he so adamant about this? Because he didn't want God's children to fall. He didn't want us to give false teachers the impression that their heretical doctrine was acceptable to us. We need to make sure that we don't become infected because of the association or the possible friendship with someone who isn't teaching the truth. And we don't need to give false teachers the ammunition to use at the next place where they stop. Now, as John is writing, he tells us in verse number 11, it says, for he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker in his evil deeds. You know what? I don't ever want to be a partaker in somebody else's evil deeds. I don't want to get wrapped up with the wrong crowd. And it's important for us to make sure that we understand. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't invite unsafe people into our homes. On the contrary, we need to make sure that we are that friendly person. There have been times when I've seen my neighbors and I've seen some things going on that I've walked over and offered to pray for them, offered to help them in whatever way that I could. And that's the way we need to be. That used to be called just being neighborly. So remember the days where your parents would tell you, hey, run next door, and if you look in the refrigerator, grab a couple of eggs. I'll let them know, or see if they have. People used to do that because they didn't lock their homes. And nowadays, Now, John wasn't saying that born-again people should never entertain in their homes. Friendship evangelism around the table is always a way to win people to Christ. It's always a way to win people to Christ. Christians need to be neighborly and hospitable. He was admonishing us not to receive or encourage false teachers who represent anti-Christian groups. People who have left the church and are now trying to seduce others another way from the Word of God. As he wraps up his letter, he tells us in verse number 12, he says, many things I have to write unto you that I would not write with paper and ink, but I trust to come to you and speak face to face, that our joy may be full. John was a loving man. And he wanted to come and tell them the truth. And it's important for us to hear and accept truth from God's men. That's why we're careful about who we invite into this pulpit. We want to make sure that they are people that are going to come and give you, thus saith the Lord, truth, and not their version. And he ends his letter by saying, the children are the church members of the elect sister, greet thee. In other words, the church that he was at. Amen. It's important for us to know the truth. It's important for us to walk in the truth, but it's important for us to abide in, to wrap ourselves up in the mantle of truth so that we don't fall away. I don't want to become a statistic. And I know that there's always that potential if I let my guard down. I need to keep my head on a swivel spiritually. Remember going to a men's study group with Brother Dave. He had a book called Point Man. If you've ever been in the military, you know the point man is the one leading the group. And he's got to keep his head on a swivel to look out for the dangers that are there. If I'm looking out for danger and you're looking out for danger as we walk through this world, guess what we can do? We can protect one another. And that's what we need to do. We need to make sure that we continue to check up on each other. That when somebody that we don't see for a little while, that we give them a call to see how they're doing. Not so that we can gossip about them. I must be whispering again, right? Brother Sean, I just heard this thing get turned way up. It's important for us to not let others fall, to have people to love and care for us. One of the duties that I have every week is to look through the roll and try to remember whether you were here or not, so that there could be a contact made to you through the mail. You know what? Sometimes we just miss the fact that you were here, and sometimes we miss the fact that you weren't here. It's not because we don't love you. But I sure do like it when people call and say, hey, Brother Rick, we're not going to be there this Sunday. This makes it easier for me to pray for you and to know that you haven't fallen away. But there are some of our brothers and sisters since this COVID thing has started that just aren't able to come. Or some people that just haven't been here. And it's not for a lack of trying. But some people we haven't been able to get a hold of. But sometimes maybe you might have better luck. Or you might live a little closer to them. Let's make sure that we're all continually walking in the truth. And that we're abiding in the truth. And most importantly, that we know the truth. Let's stand together. Tonight, the invitation is very simple. The message has been spoken. We can see what the Lord had for us. Are you walking in the truth? Are you abiding in the truth? Do you know the truth? Maybe there's someone that you just need to pray for. Or maybe you just need to come to the altar to pray. Whatever your need is, we're going to be singing page, I believe it was 435. And what a friend we have in Jesus. Father, just pray, Lord, you be with our time of invitation, Lord. I pray for your blessings upon the message. We ask your precious name. Amen. Brother Will, as you lead us.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrow share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Please be seated for just a moment. Let them finish up praying.
First of all, we have one card to read.
this morning. Mike Williams wants to let you know that he came forward and accepted Jesus Christ as the Lord and personal Savior. So please be praying for Mike. I know this is one of the things that he has struggled with. So just continue to pray for him and that the Lord would continue to work in his life. I do want to remind you that we do have our church anniversary coming up on September the 20th, and this year is going to be a little bit different. We'll have regular morning services, and then we'll break for lunch, but instead of having a pitch-in this year because of all the COVID restriction stuff, if you'd like to eat here on the grounds, please bring enough food for you and your family, and or you can go out somewhere, and then we'll have our service at 1:30. And then also don't forget about the blood drive coming up at the end of the month. Believe it or not, Tuesday starts September, and I can't believe it's already here. And so do that. And how much longer is the directory going to be out there?
Today's it?
Okay. So please make sure that you check if you haven't checked the directory. If not, we're going to put your number in just the way it is. All right? What's that? Oh, okay. Right after the services we dismiss, if the ladies would just come over here. Tony wants to talk to you about ladies' meeting, right? And that they usually have in November. So if you can come down and just meet with her, that would be good. All right. We'll be dismissed in a word of prayer. And Brother Will, if you would, please. And I promise I don't have a songbook in my hand. Come dismiss in a word of prayer, please.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the day that you've given us. Thank you for the privilege, the opportunity we have to be in your house today. I thank you for both messages that we were able to hear from Pastor today, and I pray that we will apply them to our lives, we'll take them to heart, and that we'll keep them with us throughout this week. I pray that you'll keep us safe as we head our separate ways and bring us back again together on Wednesday night and next Sunday as well. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.